Welcome to Lake Toxaway United Methodist Church and the service of worship. We have a few quick announcements to make. The first one, John Shoemaker, I'm going to let you make an announcement.
This Saturday, at the Lake Toxaway Community Center, will be hosting a Special Olympics. We have about 35 special needs folks that we've invited to come up and their families, about 120 of them. And we're going to be feeding them and have some special activities for them. But at 1 o'clock, we have organized a softball game for them. And if you have a few minutes, come by, cheer these folks on. It's something that we've done in the past, and they thoroughly enjoy it. And to see the smiles of these folks that are not as quite as fortunate as we are, it is heartwarming. So we invite you to come to the community center around 1 o'clock and put a smile on your face. Thank you.
Thank you.
This Saturday.
And then the other announcement I want to make is first to recognize Megan Brightwell. I am just going to let her raise her hand because she's on crutches. She has tore a muscle. She is a graduating senior at Rosman High School and is being awarded one of our scholarships from this church. As you know, we award several scholarships. She's planning to attend Gardner Webb University and study business. She's been duly enrolled this year at Blue Ridge, so she's earned some credits. So we're delighted and excited that you are with us this morning, Megan, and thank you for being here and letting us recognize you. Just to let you know, we are providing 7 scholarships this year at $1,500 each. 4 are for new graduating seniors from the high school, and 3 of them are returning students who continue to request that we renew their scholarships. If students request we renew, we make an effort to do that. So I appreciate your generosity in providing education to students from Rosman High School. Are there any other announcements? If not, we have gathered to worship, and I invite you to stand with me. And we will begin as we share the greeting in the bulletin. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Christ is with us.
And
our hymn of praise is hymn number 77.
Thank you.
us continue as we join in this historic confession of our faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. You have the appointed scripture passages for today in the bulletin. I invite you to follow along as together we read and we hear God's holy word. The Old Testament lesson this morning is from 1 Kings chapter 17. I'm not going to read it because it's Communion Sunday and we're a little bit larger in number, and therefore I'm going to not read it. But I do want to highlight it by saying that you remember Ahab is king of Israel, his wife Jezebel. Ahab and Jezebel have done things that are evil in the sight of the Lord. They've worshipped foreign gods. And as a result of that, Elijah, the prophet, has called a drought upon the area. And God's provided for Elijah. He had to run away from Jezebel, who was trying to kill him. And there was a stream, but it's dried up. And this story that we're not going to read is the story of him going to Zarephath and meeting a widow there, and how God provides for the widow and her son and Elijah during the time of drought, a story that many of you know quite well, or at least I hope you do. Remember, you can pull this out of the bulletin because we don't reuse it, and you can take that story, that scripture lesson home and read it. Our Psalter lesson this morning is from Psalm 146. It's from the Psalms from 145 to 150, which is the ending of the book of Psalms, are known as hymns of unending praise. So let us read this psalm responsively. Praise the Lord. Let my whole being praise the Lord.
I will praise the Lord with all my life. I will sing praises to my God as long as I live.
Don't trust leaders. Don't trust any human beings. There's no saving help with them. The person whose help is the God of Jacob, the person whose hope rests on the Lord their God, is truly happy.
God, the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, God, who is faithful forever,
who gives justice to the people who are oppressed, who gives bread to the people who are starving, the Lord who frees prisoners. The Lord who protects immigrants, who helps orphans and widows, but who makes the way of the wicked twist and turn.
The Lord will rule forever. Zion, your God, will rule from one generation to the next. Praise the Lord.
And our reading this morning for the epistle is from Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 through 24. Paul's writing to several churches of Galatia in the central part of Asia Minor. And as I said last week, he didn't have the, we read the opening salutation, it didn't have the warm fondness. Paul was upset about a lot of things that were happening in these churches because they were deserting the true faith. And so he is ready to move into his letter and address some of the things that are of concern to him in this congregation, or in these congregations. Brothers and sisters, I want you to know that the gospel I preached isn't human in origin. I didn't receive it or learn it from a human. It came straight from a revelation from Jesus Christ. You heard about my previous life in Judaism, how severely I harassed God's church and tried to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many of my peers because I was much more militant about the traditions of my ancestors. But God had set me apart from birth and called me through His grace. He was pleased to reveal His Son to me so that I might preach about Him to the Gentiles. I didn't immediately consult with any human being. I didn't go up to Jerusalem to see the men who were apostles before me either. But I went away into Arabia and I returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and stayed with him 15 days. But I didn't see any of the other apostles except James, the brother of the Lord. Before God, I'm not lying about the things that I'm writing to you. And then I went into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, but I wasn't known personally by the Christian churches in Judea. They only heard a report about me. The man who used to harass us now preaches the faith that he once tried to destroy. So they were glorifying God because of me. And herein ends the reading of the epistle lesson. Will you please stand for the reading of the gospel? In the gospel lesson, again, we deal with the story of a widow, and I'll speak more about widows and their status in the ancient world, both of the Old Testament and in Jesus' day. A little later, Jesus went to a city called Nain. His disciples and a great crowd traveled with him. And as he approached the city gate, a dead man was being carried out. He was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. A large crowd from the city was with her. And when Jesus saw her, the Lord had compassion for her and said, "Don't cry." He stepped forward and touched the stretcher on which the dead man was being carried. Those carrying him stood still. And Jesus said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." The dead man sat up and began to speak. And Jesus gave him to his mother. Awestruck, everyone praised God. "A great prophet has appeared among us," they said. "God has come to help his people." And the news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding region. This is the word of God for the people of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
And please be seated. In the movie, some of you hopefully have seen it, Mr. Holmes. Any of you know that movie? Well, you know who Sherlock Holmes is, no doubt. So in the movie, the famous detective is now 97 years old. He's retired and he's living in the countryside and he attempts in some ways to solve his greatest mystery. What had driven him to retire 35 years earlier? He's struggling with memory loss. And so he begins an investigation into his life. Now, this investigation is encouraged by the son of his housekeeper. But his housekeeper, she's a little bit skeptical about the whole thing. Holmes remembers that others had looked to him as a supremely rational person whose ability to solve crimes depended upon focusing on facts and not feelings. And what he discovers in his investigation, because remember, he's struggling with memory loss, he discovers that decades before, he had had the opportunity to get personally involved with someone in a case, and he had refused. And it had led to a death which had haunted him for 35 years. And at the end, Holmes realizes the solution not only to the mystery, but to his personal happiness, is that he has to allow himself to get personally involved. Getting personally involved makes our lives a lot more complicated. Sometimes in the church, we take pride in running things like a business. We count the cost when we make decisions, or we support those things that we think we can afford to do. But in this story from the Gospel of Luke, Jesus goes with his gut. A feeling. Literally, when getting involved with the plight of the widow of Nain, his getting involved in this life-giving episode is an example that many of us might need to follow. I would just ask you a question. Does Jesus have to get involved? Maybe not. This village is in the southern part of Galilee. It's about 20 miles from Capernaum, where Jesus, in this part of Luke's gospel, has kind of centered himself in ministry. He's traveling throughout the region, spreading the good news of God. But in some ways, this widow is really not his problem. People are dying all the time. Everybody experiences some measure of grief. Why intervene here and not elsewhere? And after all, remember, life expectancy in Jesus' day was short, as it has been throughout most of human history. I know some of you are going to say, well, wait just a minute, in the book of Genesis, we're told about extraordinary long lives. Yes, that's true. But we're also told in other places in Scripture, like Psalm 90, the one that I sometimes like to remind my wife, the days of our life are 70 years or perhaps 80 if we are strong. And earlier in the Gospel of Luke, we've met Anna, who's a widow, and she's 84 years old, and she's constantly in the temple. But judging from what we know, both from the study of archaeology and from biblical scholars, life expectancy in Jesus' day was somewhere between 30 and 35 years of age. Disease, violence, and for women, childbirth drastically shortened their lives. Now, on the other hand, a woman who had survived her childbearing years had a chance to live a longer life. But her well-being was always dependent on either her husband or her sons. Her well-being was dependent upon her relationship with a male who would support her. So when this funeral procession interrupted Jesus' entry into the village, these hard facts are evident. A young man who is the only son of the widow has died. And without a husband or a son, this widow really doesn't have a safety net except for the kindness of strangers. And she, no doubt, not only felt the grief about the death of her son, but she also was dealing with the reality that the rest of her life would be one of desperation and begging. Yet, Luke's gospel makes it clear that she was not alone, because there is a large crowd described who are wailing and weeping over the body. It kind of reminds me of an Old Testament story about Naomi. Remember that story? Naomi, whose husband first dies, and then her two sons, and she's living in a foreign land. And then she finally says to her daughters-in-laws, I'm going to return, but you need to stay here and marry other husbands. And Ruth says, no, I will go with you. Naomi was in despair because there was really no hope for her. And oftentimes, people who study that story overlook a little fact. She renames herself Mara, which means bitter. But as it turns out, Naomi's future was partially insured by the laws and customs that allowed her daughter-in-law Ruth to glean from harvested fields, and the obligation of a goel is what it was called, a Hebrew word translated redeemer kinsman. By the way, pay attention to that. Goel, el, obviously, in any of you who know any Hebrew, means something about God. A redeemer kinsman. And so Ruth gleans these fields after they've been harvested, and that's how she and Naomi survive. But none of that was clear to Naomi at the time she declared herself bitter and renamed herself Mara. In any case, here in the New Testament story, Jesus is described as having compassion for the widow of Nain. And the Greek word for compassion, my dear friends, really refers to what you and I would understand as the guts. Excuse me for my literal translation. There's even a more literal translation than that some scholars point to. In ancient times, people understood their emotions to be rooted here rather than the heart. And this decision to intervene was apparently a gut decision. And he had great compassion based on profoundly deep feelings. And that took away any hesitation he might have had about acting in this situation. How do we know that? Well, the first thing Jesus did was reassure the widow. And the second thing shocked those both in the procession and those who were with him so much that, pardon the expression, they came to a dead stop. That was supposed to be funny. You're not listening. You don't like my dead humor. Jesus touched the stretcher on which the body lay. Why did that stop the procession in its tracks? Because Jesus had ignored the boundaries of society and touched something that had touched a corpse. That was defined as unclean. And in Jesus' day, not only was that stretcher unclean, but so was the widow, because she was a woman that was not related to him. And in touching that stretcher, Jesus begins to redefine unclean and clean. Jesus was beginning to remove the barriers of fear and distress that sometimes prevent us from serving the people of God. Remember the parable of the Good Samaritan? Fear of becoming unclean probably affected the choices of those who ignored the nearly dead man on the roadside. But here in the case of this widow's son, Jesus didn't walk by. He acted. And when Jesus begins to act, he is referred to as Lord. This is what lordship and leadership look like in the kingdom that Jesus is ushering in. Jesus is truly taking on the identity for which he came. He becomes the Redeemer kinsman for this widow. And the miracle results obviously in the restoration of life for her son. It's a miracle of restoration to wholeness for the widow and of an Easter event for the son. And in Jesus we see a God who responds to sadness. A God who responds to grief, which is, yes, a part of the fabric of despair and hopelessness of the human world. But a God who promises in Scripture that we look to that day when tears will be wiped away. Yes, there may be weeping in the night, but joy comes in the morning, or the breaking in of the kingdom of God. And the crowd senses that something new has begun. And they see a direct parallel, by the way, here with this story of Jesus and the prophets of Elijah and Elisha. both who had performed similar deeds with widows. Even though I didn't read that story in the Old Testament, I want you to go home and read it. Because these widows that Elisha and Elijah, that's the story that's in the Old Testament lesson today, these widows recognize a prophet that is proclaiming God's word. And they understand that their lives matter and that God's response to our suffering is to send prophets in our midst. But the response of the spectators, fear seized them. When, and it ought to probably seize us, because when we see the action of a great and powerful God, we realize that we may not have any choice but to act. We're not great spectators in this cosmic drama of the world in which God created. We are a part of something so big and so wonderful that we're invited to imitate the love and compassion of Christ. And we should feel the suffering and need of the world in our gut. In fact, we as Christians ought to understand ourselves as a part of the safety net for the suffering of the world. And we act with compassion, with courage. And in many cases, Christians act unafraid of the limitations and the dangers that may come to them in offering acts of compassion to the suffering, the sick, and the outsiders, and the unclean. You know what I do I started to say Monday through Friday, but the reality is I do it Monday through Sunday because I went to the hospital yesterday to respond to an emergency. So I have the opportunity to do it Monday through Sunday. But I will confess to you, one of the places I have least enjoyed being in ministry is in nursing homes. I would say to you, in our culture today, those who are warehoused in nursing homes, that's what they are. You know that. Especially those who have no financial support, no families. You know what I'm talking about. The smells. You're uncomfortable because you don't like it either. But perhaps some of us are invited to offer compassion there. Or others of us perhaps are invited to offer compassion to those who live with special needs. When I go to First Methodist on Sundays, I have the joy of always being hugged by at least two adults who come to First Methodist, a group of them participate in a Sunday school class. If you've never been hugged by an adult with special needs, you've never been hugged. Hear, hear. God invites us to feel it in our guts. And to be the safety net and the love, his hands, his feet, to the suffering, to the disenfranchised, to the hopeless. And we don't come empty-handed. We come with the love of Christ. And that, after all, is how we solve the real mystery of life. The mystery of how to be happy. Because it turns out that being truly happy results from getting personally involved and performing the works of God in God's name for God's people around the world. I bring you these words in the name of Him who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. We continue together in worship this morning as our ushers come forward to receive our tithes and our offerings. Gracious God, we respond to your great gifts to us by offering these gifts to you. We bring gifts of money, of time and talents, and the gift of our lives. May they declare your praise in ways that sweeten lives with the love of Christ. Amen. Remain standing and we will sing our hymn of preparation, hymn number 298.
celebrate Holy Communion on the first Sunday of each month. All who seek to know Christ are invited to receive communion. Most of you, I think, are aware that we come to the altar. The ushers will invite you. If you're able, you may kneel, but it's appropriate to stand as well. We receive communion in this tradition by intention, meaning I will give you an individual piece of bread. John Shoemaker, one of our lay leaders, will follow, and you will dip your bread into the cup. Consume the elements. Remain at the altar till all who are with you have received the elements. I issue a blessing to each gathered group, and then you go back using the exterior aisle so that you can be seated. For those of you who come from a tradition where a prayer of confession is appropriate, I remind you that as we pray the Lord's Prayer, we are confessing our sin, and invite you to remember that we do enter this table not lightly but seriously, and that confession of sin is a part of our approaching this table. But none of us ever come worthy. It is only by Christ's love coming to us that we are invited. So let us join together in a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. When nations shall not lift up sword against nation, and neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. At his ascension, you exalted him to sit and reign with you at your right hand. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to God, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for me, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, now and forever, Almighty Father. Amen. And with the confidence of the children of God, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
words is to a gospel hymn, and I'm so glad that I'm a part of the family of God. You are a part of the family of God because of the love of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Thank you.
Again, I'm going to leave by 10:30 this morning because my son who's graduating from high school on Friday night, Megan, I have a son who's graduating from Brevard High, will be recognized at First Methodist in the worship service, and so I want to be there with my family. How blessed he is that he has this community of faith as well as the community of faith at First Methodist. I can't say enough of thank you to how much you pray for my family and support them, and how excited I am for young people like Megan and for the future. Hear this benediction. May our hearts and our guts be open. We never know when we might be invited to be a Redeemer kinsman to another child of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Spirit.
Congratulations. Good luck on the way.